Welcome, everybody. We'll just give a few more minutes. So last week we talked about getting into the ugly, ugly subject of self-hatred and things you don't like about yourself. And the homework was to write it down and to get real with God over this list of things you don't like about yourself and repent over them. And so what I'm wondering is, did anyone get any breakthrough this last week? You did your homework and maybe God revealed something to you that you didn't know before, or some type of breakthrough happened. Is that anybody would like to share? You did the homework over this last week and God brought some healing to your heart or something like that. Anybody? Anybody? Okay, don't all speak up at once. All right. Well, it's important. Hey, everybody, more people are hopping on now. If you go through the list and do what it says, it will definitely work for you. But if you don't do it, it's not going to work. So I'm going to be talking about rebellion and curses. This week's item on the list is talking about rebellion against our parents, but I'm going to talk about it, an aspect of rebellion that I think we all can relate to. So we'll just kind of wait another minute. Is Sister Renju on? I saw her. I don't know if she's still on. Oh, there she is. Hey, Renju, if you're available, maybe you want to pray and cover us before we start. Uh-oh. She's on mute.
Sorry, guys. I'm outside and I don't know how to get this filter out.
Oh, I see the filter.
Okay, I can pray.
Awesome. We'll get us started. Thanks, Renju.
Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for every sister here, Lord. Thank you for our hearts, Father God. We come before you, God. We ask, oh God, that you will help us, oh God, connect and tune in with your Holy Spirit tonight, Father God, and hear what you got for our hearts, oh God, as we work on our deliverance, Father God, as we work on being more like you, Lord. Help us, Father God. I pray for Julie as she talks, oh God. I pray that her thoughts and words will be in alignment with what you have to say today, God. Help us, Lord. We bind every spirit of interference, any witchcraft, fear, doubt, unbelief. Father, we ask, oh God, that you dig down into our hearts and help us to see the roots of rebellion and anything that we need to hear today to work ourselves through the miracle list, Father God, so we can be more like you and we can be in the image of Christ and we can have the identity that you have bought on the cross for us, Father God. We humbly ask, Father. We ask, oh God, that everything that is out of alignment, we come with godly sorrow, Father. We cry out for godly sorrow in our heart, oh God, to be truly, truly, truly aligned with you, Father God. Give us a heart that breaks for what breaks you in you, what breaks yours, God. Lord, I ask, oh God, that we lose that wisdom, the counsel, and understanding. We agree with heaven today. We agree with angels. We agree, Father God, with your ministering angels amidst us, oh God, and your Holy Spirit as we work through these things, as we work through our heart towards you, Father God, being alignment with you, Father. Thank you, Father God. We cover all these sisters with the blood of Jesus and the mind of Christ. And I ask, oh God, that you give us one heart, one mind, one accord before you, Father, because we are your children. Help us, oh God, be united in one mind before you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, good. I want to share something that I experienced last night about 1 o'clock in the morning. It was a reminder that the spirit world is real. I don't see things in the spirit, but sometimes I hear things and sometimes I can smell it. Well, I live on like a ranch, and sometimes we have coyotes yelping about. Typically coyotes, they make a bunch of noise early in the morning or at sunset. If you don't live in Arizona or you're not in a place like where they have coyotes, California's got coyotes, New Mexico does, I know. But if you're not in a place where they have coyotes, you might not know that. So typically, coyotes, yeah, they're out at night, but they make that sound, that yelping sound, typically at daybreak and at twilight in the evening. If I'm wrong, do I have any zoologists in the group? Maybe I'm wrong, but I think that's correct. So it was an odd time to hear it, what I heard, but I was kind of, I wasn't feeling very good. I got up to pray and I was walking around, and I'm in my living room. I heard what sound like a pack of coyotes, and we have horses on the property. So I went out to, I don't know, chase them off. I don't know what I was going to do, but I just went out to see, you know, do I need to call for help? You know, because sometimes the coyotes will try to attack the horses. So I went out there, and I noticed a very large bird with a black bird flew overhead, and it was perfectly still and quiet outside, which I found really strange. I was wondering, where are the coyotes? And usually you might hear them run off, you know, something. I'm sure walking out my door, they were far enough away that I doubt they would hear me. So when I came back in, I realized that I was under attack, and the Lord opened my ears to the spirit world.
Great. Be quiet, please.
And I could hear, the they're like, you know, a pack of whatever spirits off in the distance, but they are ready to attack. And so I just want you to agree with me. I say in the name of Jesus Christ, that pack of wolves or coyotes or demons or whatever you are, I rebuke you, and I command you to leave us all in the name of Jesus. You leave us all in the name of Jesus, coming against our mind, our body, our emotions, our family, our finances, our progress. We rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And all of God's daughters said, amen. Amen. Yeah. It's easy to think maybe our war that's not against flesh and blood is against flesh and blood, but I was reminded last night that our war is in the spirit world, and we have authority over the spirit world. So we don't have to be afraid. My attack also came with pain for about an hour. Yeah, it was witchcraft. I know. Yep. Come against us. That's what happens. And so it's an attack. We're doing a lot of things. Look, we are 41 of us in one accord, seeking God all together. Unity is a powerful weapon against the enemy. Okay. And wherever you have people, you're going to have problems. And so it is important for us to humbly go through life and say sorry when you need to, maybe apologize when it was their fault, okay? I don't know. I'm kind of going off right now, but I talked with my mom today. I guess we're talking about, you know, rebelling against parents, but my mom is struggling. She doesn't really know the Lord. She knows about the Lord. She used to go to church at one time, but she doesn't want to talk about the Lord. And I was trying to explain to her that we can hurt God's heart. And when we hurt somebody else by, you know, going off the handle or getting a little excited, angry, saying things we don't really mean to say, we hurt that person, but we also hurt the Lord. And that it's important for us to recognize, confess it to God. Gosh, Lord, I am so sorry. I lost my head. I lost my cool. I got a little too excited. I let my emotions take over for a minute. And I'm sorry, God, that I lost control. And when we do that, you know, Father God is like, oh, come here, daughter. I love you so much. You know, he loves that when we confess our sin to him. He wants to heal us and he wants to clean up the mess we just made with our mouth. But we have to confess. And so I'm explaining this to her and she's like, don't preach to me. You know, this is why we don't talk very often. I'm like, okay, Mom, I love you. I'm so sorry. You know, I don't mean to preach at you. And I just quickly tried to backpedal out of that because I don't want to hurt her and I don't want to cut off the communication. And maybe I said a little too much, you know, for her to handle. And she's dealing with her own stuff. And anyway, I'm just sharing my real experience. I think that if I would have tried to push her and I didn't try to make peace, then maybe I could fall into the area of dishonoring her. But I quickly recognized her frustration. I was starting to feel anxiety myself. And I'm like, no, I'm sorry, Mom. I don't mean to make you feel bad. You know, and I just kind of backpedaled. Let's change the subject. You know, I apologized and quickly got out of there. That was my way of whole, you know, let's keep talking, but let's move into a different space. So anyway, what I wanted to talk about tonight, I thought it was appropriate. Let's talk a little bit about rebellion and curses. And maybe as I share some scriptures, you'll be able to detect whether or not you maybe have a curse on your life, or maybe you're putting curses on other people's lives. And that is possible. You might say, well, how's that possible? I thought only witches and warlocks could curse people. Well, the scripture tells us differently. So let's take a look at it. So I want to share with you, there's a dictionary that's written in 1828. You ever hear of it? The dictionary 1828, it takes its definitions from the Bible. So this dictionary has many, many references from the Bible. It's called the 1828 dictionary. Maybe someone can drop that in the chat. So it defines rebellion like this: open resistance to lawful authority, to treat the king's authority with contempt. We have a king. We have a president, but it's Webster's 1828. Thanks, Ellen. We have a president, but there's a king of this world, right? The prince of darkness. He's really the kingdom of this world we live in. But we, as children of God, we have a king, heavenly king. And when we treat his authority or his law with contempt, meaning we go against it, we are in rebellion. All have fallen short all have sinned, and we will continue to do so. But what we have is the opportunity to repent, right? So remember Saul. He became king, and he rebelled against God's ways. What he was told to do, he didn't do it. And 1 Samuel 15:23, I believe this is Samuel speaking. He said, "For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king." And so Saul was rebellious against, he was openly resistant to lawful authority. God, the Father, right? He gave him instructions about how to handle the spoils from a war, I believe. And he didn't do what he was supposed to do. He did his own way. The word says there's a way that seems right to a man, but its way ends in death. And so in Saul's case, he rebelled. And Samuel, the prophet, told him this rebellion is like, it is as, it is like the sin of witchcraft. And we know that the sin of witchcraft brings a curse. And that curse can travel 3 and 4 generations. And he rejected the word of the Lord. The Lord rejected him as king. It was pretty serious. Not only that, but he did die, and his sons died, and it was just really horrible, everything that happened. Curses. Now, curses, the Webster Dictionary of 1828 says, it's the expression of a wish of evil to another. To utter a wish of evil against one, or to call for injury to fall upon. To injure. To subject to evil, to vex, to harass, to torment with great calamities, to condemn. That's cursing. That's cursing. When you do something just to harass somebody, just to get under their skin, you are cursing them. When you wish evil to befall another, you wish something harmful to happen to another. Oh, Lord, just take my son who's in drugs. Just have him crash, Lord. Have something terrible happen to him. You are actually speaking a curse upon that person. Oh, Lord, like he's riding that motorcycle. Lord, I pray that he get into an accident to teach him a lesson that he shouldn't be riding the motorcycle without a helmet. You have just sent a curse. Wow. Remember, life and death is in the power of your tongue. And when you say things like, teach him a lesson, let something bad happen to that person, you are cursing them, just like a witch curses. Yeah, so we should not pray that they go through a trial to humble them. No. Mm-mm. Lord, bring evil upon this person to teach them a lesson, to humble them. That is a witchcraft curse. That's a witchcraft prayer. And so you got to repent, okay? You got to repent. Let's keep our comments on the chat to a minimum. If you have a specific question, you can wait till later, or direct message one of the ministers, please. So here it says, Exodus 22 says, "Thou shalt not curse the ruler of thy people." How many of you have wished for President Biden to keel over? Yeah. How many of you have wished for something negative to happen to the president? All right. You've heard people talk like that, though. Yes. Right. That is a curse that's sent out on the wings of demons to bring it to pass. Deuteronomy 28:47-48 said this, because you did not serve the Lord your God with joy and gladness of heart for the abundance of everything. This does not say because you did not serve the Lord. It says because you didn't serve the Lord with gladness for the abundance of everything. Therefore, you shall serve your enemies, whom the Lord will send against you, in hunger, in thirst, in nakedness, in need of everything, and he will put a yoke of iron on your neck until he has destroyed you. So the king's law, rule, the way of the Lord, right? In the Ten Commandments, we have this, Exodus 20:12, it says, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you. I went to a funeral when I was in high school. It was a girl named Stacy Krieger. I remember this. We were in 10th grade. I sat next to her in history class. And she crossed the road one evening as she was working. I don't know what happened, but she got hit by a car and she died. We were in 10th grade. And I remember going to the Catholic funeral, and the priest said, well, she was too good for this world, and God needed her in heaven. Now, there is a story, which I haven't been able to find yet. If someone knows where it is, let me know, about a young person who died early because his dad was the king, and he was an evil king, and God spared him. I don't know where that story is, but I heard that that's in there somewhere. I don't know where. If anyone knows where it is, please let me know. But here it says, if you honor your father and mother, then your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you. We have a promise to live long if we honor our parents. Now, I would venture to guess that half of you in some way dishonored your parents. I know I did. I used to break the rules all the time. My mom, she'd get a little overexcited, a little emotional, and I would kind of laugh at her. Like, it was just a little too overboard, you know, it was too much. And I don't know, maybe it was a nervous laughter, but I think most of it was like, are you kidding me? Like, I spilled the milk. Why are you freaking out? Like, it's not a big deal. But it was dishonoring to her. And so when I first learned about this, I had to go back and repent, and I called her and apologized to her. I apologize for many things, especially in my teenage years, that I was fought with her a lot. I argued with her a lot. So then in Deuteronomy 5:16, it says something a little more. It's a more explanation. It says, honor your father and mother as the Lord your God has commanded you, right? He commanded us in the Ten Commandments, that your days may be long, and it may go well with you in the land. So not that you'll have a long life only, but that your long life will go well. No, I don't think your grandmother counts as your parent. Just a quick answer there. Because it talks about who gave birth to you in the scripture. I could be wrong about that, but I think we should honor the people who raised us for sure. You can't go wrong by honoring. And if you did dishonor, if it was your grandmother, grandparent, or aunt, uncle, whatever, adopted parent, to apologize to them. Proverbs 23:22 says, listen to your father who gave life, you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old. Now I'm going to stop here for a second. Some of you are taking notes. What I want you to do is I want you to jot down, when you hear a blessing, write it down. on one side of the page. When you hear something that sounds like a curse, write it down on the other side of the page. So here it says, honor your father and mother, right? So that it may go well with you, so that you may live, so your days may be long upon the earth. That is a blessing, right? That you would live a long life. Another blessing is that it, your life, may go well with you. So you have two blessings there. Long life and a good life. And a good life. Okay, some instruction, right? Proverbs says, listen to your father who gave you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old and irritable and irrational. My mom can be a little irrational sometimes. And the scripture says, don't despise her. Don't despise your mom when she's, you know, tells the same story 15 times. Don't despise her when she's old. Matthew 15:4 says, for God commanded, honor your father and mother. Whoever reviles, which means criticizes in an abusive or angrily insulting manner. If you criticize your mother or father in an abusive or an angrily manner, you are reviling them. Okay? Or with contempt, you're arguing. It's an arguing. It says here, this is Jesus, right? He said, anybody who does that, whoever reviles them, must surely die. That would be a curse. More instruction here from Ephesians 6:1 says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for it is right. For it is right. Proverbs 30:17 says, the eye that mocks a father and scorns to obey a mother. I'll stop there for a second. This scorns, I had to look it up. So the eye that mocks a father and scorns, this is a belief or a feeling that one is worthless. So when you scorn, when you kind of look upon somebody, like it says to obey a mother, you kind of look at them like, what you're telling me to do is worthless. I have no need of that. I have no, it's stupid to me. I'm not going to obey what you're telling me. Okay. It says, I that mocks a father and scorns to obey a mother will be picked out by the ravens of the valley and eaten by the vultures. This is the eye. Now, think about the eye. The eye is the thing that gives light to our body, right? The word says. The eye gives us vision for the future. Our eye helps us see what really is. If the ravens and the vultures, which are predatorial birds, what are those things? Those are evil spirits. They can take away our vision. They can affect us if we're a mocker. So if we mocked our parents, or we fall into that trap of mocking or just thinking whatever they're saying is completely worthless, I'm not going to listen to you, you know, then you risk you're at risk for this curse of your vision in life being plucked out. That would be a curse. Proverbs 20:20. Interesting. 20:20, vision. Think about that. If one curses, wishes evil or harm, his father or his mother His lamp will be put out in utter darkness. Where is utter darkness? Does anybody know? Utter darkness is hell. I believe that. Mm-hmm. The dogs are in utter darkness. Wow. Wishing harm upon your mother or father can put you at risk of ending up in utter darkness. Ouch. So that would be a curse, right? Yeah. Proverbs 18:21. Here it is. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. My mouth has gotten me in trouble in the past. Can anybody relate to me? Right. I'm like, no, don't. How'd you get out of there? We all should be wearing masks sometimes so we don't let it out of our mouth. Yeah. When that, I'll call it, it's anger, right, ladies? When that frustration and that anger and that irritation just bubbles up and your mind, the devil's been working on your mind, negative thinking, and they did it because of that. And that's, you know, they are trying to manipulate me and I shouldn't fall for it. I got to stand up for myself. And your mind's going. And then that feeling rises up within and then you're spewing crap out of your mouth. Oh, man, it's bad. I'm just saying, maybe somebody can relate to that. It is death. It is death. James 3:2. This is a very good reminder, and I might talk a little bit more about this. Oh, in Ecclesiastes. Okay, so James 3:2 says, we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body. Look at also at the ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by every small rudder, by a very small rudder, wherever the pilot desires. Even so the tongue, it is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles? And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and creature of sea is tamed, and has been tamed by mankind, but no man can tame the tongue. It's an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it, we bless our God and Father, and with it, we curse men who have been made in the image of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessings and cursings. My sisters, these things ought not be so. Like I said, our words are heard in the spirit world. And I'm going to read you Ecclesiastes 10:20 to prove it. Curse not the king, no, not in thy thought. And curse not the rich in your bedchamber or in your bedroom. For a bird of the air shall carry the voice. That which has wings shall tell the matter. Moreover, okay, this is the amplified version. Moreover, I'm just going to read it again. Do not curse the king, even in your bedroom and in your sleeping rooms. Do not curse the rich, for a bird of the air will carry the sound, and a winged preacher will make the matter known. Now, people ask me, they get concerned. Well, is it gossip if I talk about the harm someone's doing to me. No. Am I cursing somebody if I just talk about how I'm being affected by what they're doing or saying or whatever? No. To curse, like I read you, is to wish harm upon somebody. So I've had issue with some people in my life, and one person was talking, I don't know, they were not saying nice things about me, and that hurt my feelings. So I shared it with a friend, and then that friend said, oh, you know, that person, she said some not nice things to me too. Okay. We're sharing information. That's not gossip. Okay. And it's not, we're not cursing her by sharing this stuff. These are facts. This is the facts. This is what happened. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, Patricia, what'd you say? Please, someone list these scriptures in the chat. Oh, I'm probably going too fast for that, but maybe someone can. Patricia asked if we could list the scriptures in the chat. Gossip then is when you're talking about a matter is one thing. Going on and coming to conclusions and then spreading information for the purpose of spreading information, that is gossip. Think about it this way. There was a football player, a football coach, and he worked at a college. I don't know what college, but it came out that when some of the athletes that he had, they grew up, and one of them shared that this football coach had molested him. Well, another athlete, heard about it and said, oh my gosh, he did the same thing to me. And then another person came forward. And it turned out that there were scores of young boys who had been molested by this coach. But they were, you know, they didn't say anything when they were 10, 11 years old. But when they got older, one person spoke up. And then another. And then another, and it became a big deal. And that man went to prison. I kind of see it the same way. When a person is causing harm, right? I've had it where someone, you know, let's say a sister I'm working with is kind of acting in a bully type way. I have been in that atmosphere where I was bullied in the workplace, and I had to write up a grievance, and it was a big mess. I wouldn't have done anything, but it was so grievous that I had to do something. And so I got a taste of what it felt like to be bullied as an adult. So I get into ministry, and this is a few years ago, where I noticed the same type of behavior was happening from this one individual. And I didn't say anything at first. And then one person came to me and shared a concern that the way this other sister was treating them. And I was like, oh my gosh, she did the same thing to me. And then in another conversation, somebody else revealed. And then I shared it with a friend, and they're like, the same thing happened to me. Next thing we know, we have this whole conglomeration of people who had been essentially being bullied by this one person. If we didn't speak up, if no one said anything ever, that person still be hurting others. Were we gossiping? Did some of the conversation maybe border gossip? Possibly. But when you're working through it, you're like, I don't understand. I was right behind her and the door slammed in my face. What was that about? You know, as you begin to kind of like analyze each situation and say, wow, what is going on here? What is going on? And so I think the gossip is, you know, you reveal it, you talk about it. When you get to the point where you start speaking evil of that person, you start judging them. I admit I probably did say, you know, this person is a bully. I came to a conclusion. I was like, I can't trust this person because of everything that I saw happening. Eventually that person was ushered out. But it happens. If you're in a grouping of people, and a lot of times just women, it's women, right? men don't typically deal with this stuff. If a man's got a beef with another man, they usually deal with it. And sometimes, you know, not the most godly way they deal with it, but they deal with it and it's over. Women, we, you know, and a lot of prayer went in, and what did I do wrong? And how could have I acted differently? And I'm going to, you know, apologize. And, you know, you go through all that stuff. And was I perfect in the situation? No, I can't say I was. I cannot say it. But I'm glad that people spoke up, because then I was praying and God did. He blew the lid off of what was happening. And of course, it wasn't the person, it's the spirit working through the person. So it was really easy for me to forgive the person and release those negative feelings, because, you know, no one likes to be disrespected or dishonored. You are muted. How could I possibly be muted? It's just you. Okay, can you guys hear me? It's just you, Sister Renju. Okay, she just said I was muted. Oh, thank you. Well, I think what I want to do is, I'll just read this. So another scripture I want to share is Ephesians 4:29. I'm going to move off this topic, okay? It says, do not let unwholesome... And this is the Amplified version, so it's not your New King James, okay? I like how it spells it out. It says, do not let unwholesome, foul, profane, this is all unwholesome talk, foul, profane, worthless, or vulgar words come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good for building up others according to the need and the occasion, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear you speak. 1 Peter 3:10 says, for he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Deceit is deception, falsehood, or misleading. You know, we can say things that lead a person to conclusion. We have to be careful about that. That is dishonoring. That is dishonoring. Okay. Proverbs 21:23. Whoever guards his mouth and tongue keeps his soul from trouble. That sounds like a good plan. Let's keep our souls from trouble. Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. I recently had someone use a harsh tone with me, and it was unnecessary, but it stirred up something in me. It really did. I had to really forgive that person. I had to pray for them. This person's getting a lot of prayer. I got one person in my life right now. He is getting a lot of prayer. If you got somebody in your life who just, they trigger you. They just know how to say things at the right time, the exact thing. They know how to say it with the right tone just to push your button. That's God's way of recruiting you as an intercessor for them. So So shoot, this person's going to have a breakthrough in my life. I'm praying for her, her kids, her finances, her job, her car, her life, everything, her romance life. This woman's getting blessed. Because whenever, you know, this, you know, whenever there's a little exchange and there's a bad attitude or there's a little something, and not to say, you know, we all got stuff going on in our own lives. Like I was up in the middle of the night, you know, fighting coyotes. And you know, you got to get up early, you got to do your work. And then and then your person who you work with or whatever, or you live with, pushes that right button and you're like, ah. God doesn't want us to dishonor anybody though. But sometimes we need to ask for help. All right. Sometimes we have to ask for help. I'd like to read Proverbs 12:18. There is one who speaks like the piercing of a sword, but the tongue of the wise promotes health. You know, kids are quick to tell on each other. Mom, he said this, he did that, she, you know, kids are quick to tell. I think we as children of God should be slow to tell. Unless, of course, there's some physical abuse, emotional abuse, sexual abuse, spiritual abuse, even. I think, you know, a few years ago, I heard someone complain they felt like this other minister was spiritually abusing them. And when I heard that term, I said, now is time for me to get help. Time to get help. And I did. I got that person help. So I think also if you're in an organization, you're all working together, and maybe there's that one person who's just not a team player. And they're, you know, there's one thing, just someone's got a bad attitude. Okay, you know, whatever. But when someone's malicious and it happens to multiple people, you end up talking about it because it's all you know, this one person is affecting 5-6 of you. That I think you got to go to leadership. Got to go to leadership. Maybe someone needs to hear that. So, I did want to tell you a quick story. How much time do I have? Okay, good. I want to tell you a story about the birds of the air carrying a message. I don't know, maybe it was a year ago, I did a woman's seminar, and the seminar was basically on the personality, demonic personalities. It was a little teaching I put together. Whether it was good or not, I don't know, but I know after I did the seminar, and a lot of people got healed, it was good. I felt bad. I had a lot of like chatter in my mind about I could have did this differently, and I could have spent more time on that. And you know how the enemy is, right? Attacking your mind, criticizing. And I'm like, yeah, I should have did this, maybe that. Okay, next time I'll change. And so it was a lot of chatter in my mind. But the next day I felt uncharacteristically sad. I felt depressed. I was crying on and off throughout the day. I just felt very heavy. I felt very sad. And I even called a friend to get prayer. And I was like, I don't know what's wrong with me. I mean, I know maybe the seminar wasn't the greatest and okay. So, but I don't understand why I feel so sad. And I felt very, very depressed. Well, and this was, like I said, over a year ago. There was a person at the seminar who I guess didn't like it. And I got a call Monday morning. So Saturday was the seminar. Monday I fell in this dark depression, and I was awakened Monday morning to a phone call. And it was one of the sisters at the ministry, and she was crying. And she confessed to me that she had been speaking very poorly about the seminar. And she had been talking bad about me. And I said, she's asked me for forgiveness. And of course I forgave her. But once I forgave her, I felt the depression lift off me. I felt a real physical release from that spirit of depression. Now, it says that we need to be careful what we say in the secret in our bedroom. And I don't think it means just the king. I think King Solomon is trying to teach us something about how the spirit world works. And when we talk evil, slanderous, I don't know what she said, what she was saying. I have no idea. Lord, I could have done it better. You know, I don't know. Maybe she, I have no clue what she didn't tell me. I didn't ask. I did not ask. But what I do know is she confessed to me and it lifted. And so she said I was speaking bad. She was basically cursing me. And a bird of the air carried those words and dropped it on me. Okay. And you might say, well, you know, a curse without a cause isn't going to land. You must have been in sin in some way. I don't know. I don't know anybody that doesn't have any open doors, even a little crack. Okay. Introduce me to them. The point is this. When we speak negatively about a person, it has real spiritual consequences. When you cursed your mother, when you cursed your father, you set in motion spiritual consequences. Now, I think a lot of you on here tonight, you've already gone to the Lord, you've cried, you've repented, you've dealt with it before God. And a lot of you, I know some of you personally on here, you've made the phone call. You've called and said, you know what, Mom, I want to apologize for always arguing with you and not trusting you or whatever. I know I had to apologize. I broke the rules. I'd sneak out of the house. I didn't help around the house. She wanted more help. I didn't do it. I didn't want to be home, whatever my reason was, right? But I called and I said, you know what? I'm sorry that I wasn't more helpful. I'm sorry that I wasn't more cooperative, Mom. I'm sorry that I was a rebellious teenager and I asked you to forgive me. And it was a real beautiful phone call between the two of us because she doesn't cry, but you know, I was crying a little bit and I was really saying, you know what? I messed up. And, I recognize that, and I want to say I'm sorry to you for that. Some of you have messed up, like some of you have been super sinners, as Mike calls them, and you know, maybe you ended up in jail, or you ended up addicted to drugs, or, you know, you really broke your mom's heart. Okay, yeah, you have to, you know, you got to just go, you just got to call them and apologize. Okay, what if you already did that? Then you're good. Don't worry about it, okay? So does that mean you're off the hook for the week? No, I want you to think about how maybe your tongue is getting you in trouble, okay? If you have not dealt with the sin against your parents, then you need to deal with that. Okay. It's the number three on the miracle list is this. It says, if you were raised by dysfunctional parents, and you rebelled against them in your youth and dishonored them, the demons put a curse on you. And so I read some scriptures that hopefully helped you think, well, do I have a curse on my life? Are my finances always falling through? That is a a sign that you might have a curse? Do you have a bunch of physical ailments that could be a curse? Do your relationships always fall apart? That could be a curse. Okay. So, like I said, what this miracle list is doing, it's helping you investigate what do you need to, you know, deal with in your life. Even if your parents were at fault, your parents were dysfunctional, they were, you know, you had a single mom, she was yelling all the time, she worked a couple jobs, she was never home, you rebelled, did your own thing, you know, it doesn't matter if your parents were on drugs or they abused you, you still are responsible to repent for this rebellion towards them, because you got to break the curse on your life. Okay? So it doesn't matter what they did to you. That was demons making them do it, telling them to abuse you. It was evil spirits telling them to ignore you and criticize you and cause your life to be difficult. So you have to forgive them, right? We took care of that, hopefully, number one. And now you have to recognize, wow, I never really dealt with this with my parents. Maybe my life is in shambles because I have a curse on it. Okay? So you have to renounce and repent for the sin of rebellion against your parents. Okay? If you just read over this and not do anything with it, the curse is going to stay. And now you have more information, it actually could get worse. Okay. So you're gaining knowledge here. It says, apologize to them, your parents, if they're alive. Apologize to God. Release them out of your soul to God and let them go. That's not a 1, 2, 3 process. It can be very difficult to let go of the ought and the yuck inside, okay? So you gotta really work at this, and I'm giving you 1 week to do it, okay? Like, make it a priority this week. You've been trying to get through, you know, if they're deceased, then you're apologizing to God, and you gotta release your parents out of your soul. Okay, you can't apologize to them, but you can still release them out of your soul, those negative feelings you have towards them still. And you know, you have a Heavenly Father now. You don't need parents. We're all adults here, right? We have a Heavenly Father now, and we don't need a mom and dad. So number three on the miracle list is breaking the curse the demons put on you when you dishonored your mother and your father, okay? And so if you already took care of that, which, like I said, I see several of you here, you already dealt with it, then what you want to do is think about your mouth. Are you speaking word curses on people? Okay? You might have a curse on your life because somebody's been speaking word curses on you. But I want you not to focus on that. I want you to focus on yourself. Deal with yourself and how's your language. When we have negative thoughts about somebody and we speak them out of our mouth, or we pray prayers that you know, maybe you didn't know you were praying some word curse prayers. Oh Lord, have them have a mental breakdown so they'll come to you. Yeah, no, don't pray like that. we don't want any harm to come to anybody. We do want our, you know, we want our loved ones to come to know the Lord. And I do pray, Lord, do whatever you have to do to bring them to the knowledge of Jesus, you know. But we don't want to wish evil upon anyone, okay? And that would be cursing them. Which curse was? Okay, someone's writing in the chat. All right. Does anyone have any questions for me about this topic? Any questions? Any comments? Anything? Okay, here. Serious iniquity. Yes. What about my dad's? Okay. Patricia, right? So your dad's, she would essentially be your stepmother, right? Is that right? Yeah, so you have to forgive her. And you could call her up and ask her for forgiveness if you did something to hurt her. And you got to release all the bitterness that maybe she did bad things to you or made you feel a certain way. That bitterness, hey, where's Sister Renju? Is she on still? Hey, Renju, I got a question for you. She's busy. Okay. Where's Ellen? Is Sister Ellen on?
Yes.
Oh, good. Thanks. Hey, what is it that, isn't there a type of cancer that can manifest in a person if they have bitterness towards a woman in their life?
Usually breast cancer.
Breast cancer. Sorry, Julie. Yeah.
Okay, cancer. Breast cancer. Yeah, it's on one. What side is it on?
I believe if it's your mom, it's the right.
Okay.
And if it's another woman, it's the left. I may be wrong on the right and left, but it's specific like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Ellen, can you confirm or deny?
Yes, I confirm. I would have to double check the right, left, but yes, one is immediate family member. Like one would be your mother or your sister, and then one would be your mother-in-law, you know, would be a good example of the non-blood relative.
Or like a stepmother.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
I got to tell you, thank you, ladies, so much for that clarification. I don't know how long ago, maybe 5 or so years ago, the Lord revealed to me that I had serious, serious anger and ought towards my stepsister. And I remember the day that, well, I know when it started. And then I remember specifically the deliverance I went through to release the anger and the bitterness towards her. I mean, she rejected me from the day I met her. And it was really terrible. So yeah, okay. So like my stepsister, I wrote her a letter to apologize, and she refused to receive any communication from me. Okay. So essentially, she's like saying, you're dead to me. Even though I knew her since I was 5 years old. And we graduated together. I mean, we went to the same school, everything. Like, she was my stepsister my whole life. But I tried to make amends with her when God was dealing with me about this, and she refused to hear anything from me. So, of course, that was another rejection, right? I had to deal with that. But I remember it was a very powerful deliverance of releasing the pain and the rejection and the bitterness out of my soul. And then afterwards, I just confessed I actually love her. And I spent some time praying for her and her children. I used to feel a little jealous or envious of her when I see my stepmom post some Facebook pictures, but all of that negativity is gone. And I thank God, because that is a prime example of setting me up for breast cancer. 100%. Okay, what are some tips to do with angry parents if you're living with, example, they yell? Move out? Okay. if you can't move out, if maybe you're, you know, whatever reason you can't move out, you want to pray for them. You want to keep your own mouth in check, right? And you want to learn how to bind the spirits. You want to bind the spirits. You don't do it in front of them. You can do it in your room. And you need to learn about binding and loosing. Jesus called it the keys to the kingdom. And they really work. You can bind the spirits in another person. I bind that spirit of anger. Yeah, how do I bind and loose? Could somebody, maybe that wouldn't work. We have a teaching, Sister Renji and I, we did a little, have a little discussion about binding and loosing on the YouTube channel. And when I send out the email for next week, I'll include that. Okay. You can go on hardcorechristianity.com on YouTube, go to the Steps to Freedom channel on there and look for binding and loosing. It's probably the only teaching on there about binding and loosing, but it's just a really simple, practical teaching about how to essentially do this binding and loosing. And that will really help if you're living with people who, you know, are anger, their spirits are causing them to say things and do things that are not loving and godly, then you want to bind the spirits in them so that you're, when I say binding, you're essentially tying up the spirits. Okay. Who are you limited to with that? Nobody. Nobody. So when we bind, say, the spirit of rejection, and I loose the spirit of acceptance. I bind the spirit of fear, and I loose the spirit, I loose the power of a power, love, and a sound mind. Okay. So I take the thing that I see in the person operating, that spirit of, you know, anger, and I loose peace. I bind the spirit of anger and I loose the peace of God. I loose cooperation. Okay. I loose love. Absolutely. Yeah. You can make a big long list. Okay. There it goes. Sister Renji posted it in the chat. I don't know if how you get that downloaded, but, or maybe you can copy and paste it. Who knows? But that should help. And I need to get back to doing it, because what occurred for me last Friday, I definitely now, I'm like, I need to bind the spirits that are operating at my workplace so I can have more peace. So maybe you need to do that too. We just need a reminder. Okay. I would like to pray for you ladies. And-